No, not ironically. I think it's perfectly, I mean, it's very much to the point. I thought yesterday's session was a pretty good session, a very good session as far as teaching was concerned. It was a lousy session artistically. And that's why I was so troubled. As much as I am invested in talking to you and teaching you the process and analyzing it and working through it and illuminating it for you in the terms and manner of a critic well, the strange thing is, what you see before you is a creature who is trying to be both the bird and the ornithologist. The bird and the ornithologist. And if the bird just starts flying and then has to, it suddenly has no wings, but is standing off in the brush with binoculars to his eyes, you can imagine the strange sort of morphing back and forth that goes on. And that's what happened last night. And I spent too much time in the weeds with my binoculars last night. As useful as that is, and as much as you might learn about birds and even flight from that, if your heart is the heart of a bird, it's very difficult. It's painful. And last night I was the ornithologist way too much and the bird far too little. Was exacerbated by the fact that the legitimate work I did last night was I did a fair amount of polishing, of going back to the work that had been done and re-entering it, re-dreaming it, and listening for, looking for, being aware of those moments when the dream fades, when the dream is out of sync, when the dream suggests that it had stopped when it first happened, and that for a brief time something else crept in. And so I did a good deal of that last night. Now, that is also bird work, but it also lends itself to the ornithologist really easily. So I was toggling last night between bird and ornithologist very rapidly. Then I had very little time to actually write. And on top of that, I was in a place, and this is really interesting, that which made it worse. I think all of that would have been all right if I hadn't really come upon a section in which, and this happens to everyone, and you could know in your bones how crucial it is to stay in the dream. You can know in your bones how crucial it is to resist proceeding in a work by means of analysis and by the will and by ideas and by thoughtfulness. And I know those things in my bones. I've been teaching it for 17 years. I've been practicing it for 20 years, more than 20 years in my writing. But you still fight the battle. And so last night, I felt like a piece of crap. And it was because of too much analysis, too much dwelling in that aspect of things. Just because I spent too much time doing it, even though there are a lot, and because there are a lot of things on that level to say to you. But also because the kind of polishing work I did lends itself to that. But perhaps even more significantly, if you remember last night's passages, and maybe it's a good, let's go back and look at it. And look, I mean, the ironies and paradoxes abound in this kind of a project. And here I am. I'm about to go back and analytically, I'm in the same mode of discourse, the same mode of concentration as I was last night that produced the lousy feelings I had all night. And yet here I am back in that mode explaining how this same mode of discourse put me in the lousy mode. It's like a hall of mirrors here. And if tomorrow I'm in a lousy mood because I was in this other mode, I may well explain that about this, about that. Anyway, you can see how that multiplies. But we're not going to do as much of this tonight because in that wonderful time of driving in those dark, along that dark Highway 27 coming into Tallahassee from Jefferson County, I think I had an insight as to what went wrong. And I'm not talking about what went wrong in too much teaching. I think I could have overcome all that if it hadn't been for the fact that I also have been working from my head in a couple of ways in this story. Up to go about your business, all of you, just go about your business. That's this part right here. Up to there, I think the story, I am very pleased with the story. And you know I struggled with this last night. You saw me struggling. At first, I lifted my eyes to the window. I saw Earl Sant's plane there, something like that. That's what I had started out with. It was almost implying a kind of hallucination on Paul's part. Then I went somewhere else altogether. About having seen men, dead men before. And then I came back to the plane, and I thought I had fixed it by just pulling him one step back. Instead of him seeing Earl Sant's plane there, he embraces the notion that he's imagining it. Well, I got to tell you something. The notes I took in my first night and then a little later on that is hanging right here next to me include the fall of the plane over and over. And I'm aware of the fact that he saw the plane once and then he saw it again in a dream. And indeed, he didn't, and the dream turned into a kind of waking dream there as well. But there have been two major incidents, the plane falling and him seeing it again that night. And he goes to work, he hears people talking about this event, and he's getting irritated with them because it's drawing things up in him that he doesn't want to deal with. And where I went next was actually, that choice was made by my thinking, all right, I've done it. He saw it. He's remembered it once. He's got to remember it again. So I'll do it here. I really understand now that my going to this moment was a willed thing based on a conception of the story. And though the dream storming that I had done about this story, I think legitimately brought up a sense of Paul replaying the moment. And he may yet in the story legitimately, I don't know. But in having firmed up, in having validated and institutionalized that legitimate dream space thing, with that phrase on this paper hanging here, sees the plane fall over and over. At some point then, it took on a life of its own, a preconceived structural thing, an idea about the story. Even though it began as an intuition about the story, having formalized it it took on a kind of abstract authority, quasi-authority. And so I tried to force that sense of that aspect of the story into this moment, and it was not right for it. And by the same token, and you can't even trust nighttime highways to do the right thing by you. If you are taking the risk and of dreaming about your story removed from the real work of sentence to sentence writing, because on the night a couple of nights ago when I came up with some other I think still very legitimate images of where the story is going. For instance, Paul going back to the crash site. On that same evening, I considered a note that I had made in the very first dreamstorming that I had done on this story, on that first night. The note about high up skyscraper, New York City. This was an era in the early, in the first two decades of the 20th century, the era of skyscrapers. Skyscrapers were, you know, in rapid succession, individual buildings became the tallest building in the world because the skyscraper technology was just blooming then. There was the Masonic Hall in Chicago, Illinois, believe it or not, was the tallest building in the world for a brief time. And then there was the Singer Building in New York City was the tallest building in the world, I think, sort of in this time frame. Although I think it was quickly superseded by another skyscraper, Metropolitan Building or something. And then eventually by the Chrysler Building briefly, and then the Empire State Building. By the way, these are not things that I have looked up since I got interested in this story. I've long been interested in skyscrapers. I love them. And so I've done just casually, just for my own interest, a fair amount of reading about them. And so these are just things, that these are bits of pieces of knowledge I have just floating around in my head. But on that night, a couple of nights ago, when I was getting good dreamscape stuff happening for me, dreamstorming, by golly, the notion of a skyscraper sort of floated into me. And I instantly, and now I realize that I instantly flipped out of out of the right place in myself and into the wrong place. It's a very tricky thing, folks. It really is. This thing I'm calling on you to do, you need to be patient with yourself, because even when you understand that you should do it, not only just understand intellectually, even when it's built into your process in some deep way, you constantly fight the battle. Because what I did was, the skyscraper sort of slid back into my consciousness, and I immediately stepped back from it, and I looked at it, and what happened was, and I think it's partly attributable to these things that we've been doing together, I have been much more openly explicit about the connection of this story to the events of September 11th than I would ever have been if I had just been writing the story from my deep connection to it. I would not have been letting myself even consider that in any fully vested analytical way. But I've, given the circumstances of this project, I have. And by the way, it's not, you know, the project, I think, in that kind of duality, it's not such an artificial thing, because I'm thinking back to my early days when I was writing badly. I don't know if I've mentioned this, but I think I may have. But before I began to publish in 1981, before I wrote The Alleys of Eden, which was my first novel, and I published in 1981. Before that, for the, 9 years I was trying to be a fiction writer before I published The Alleys of Eden. And during that period, I wrote 5 really dreadful novels, about 40 god-awful short stories, and a dozen terrible full-length plays. And you know, I think one of the problems was that the basic problem was is in a way reflected in the struggles that I'm going through here. That indeed I was writing very much with that analytical faculty actually turned on virtually all the time. Sometimes a bit of language or something I'd veer into some legitimate aspect of my unconscious, and I would have little bursts of things that really were coming from there or close to there. But by and large, I was very comfortable in writing my story in exactly the frame of mind that I am in, not when I'm here with my music on working, but in the frame of mind that I am in when I'm talking to you. I would write and not talk, of course, but certainly the things I'm saying to you, the same sorts of things would be very much present in my mind and would be informing the decisions that I was making. I would be moving forward based upon my intellectual understanding of motif and of structure and this and that, and that's why the work failed. And it happened a couple of nights ago. Because that analytical part of me went, well, you know, if I let Paul have had an experience in a New York skyscraper being up high, that's just going to be too heavy-handed. It's just going to be too much of a parallel to September 11th. And the decision not to let myself go there, which I made on that night, externally, away from this, from the moment of creation. The decision I made that night was a willed decision, was an analytical decision, was a thoughtful decision, was a decision not based on the internal dynamics of this story or of the character, but were in fact based on a thoughtful thing. And if some of you are going, yeah, well, that does sound kind of heavy-handed, I would suggest that you reconsider as I'm now doing. Because you too, you also, in following this story, if you have been through all of our sessions, you have been drawn with me into that kind of hyper-awareness of the motifs and the elements and the parallels and the resonances and all of that stuff in terms that are that's what's heavy-handed. And honestly, if someone were to encounter this story well apart from all this stuff that I've been saying around it and during it, I think that whatever parallels there are here, whatever resonance is here, even, you know, is going to be perfectly fine and subtle enough, even if, in fact, our banker, Earl Sant, had been to New York City. And, he's a Pennsylvania banker, and his bank could well have its main branch in New York City, or there could be a bankers' convention or whatever. New York was the center of commerce and, which is why 9/11 happened. But it was a center of commerce even in the beginning of the 20th century. And he could easily, very plausibly, have been there. And if he was, given his interest in this plane, given his interest even in banking, in commerce, these enormous buildings would have been objects of some considerable interest to him. He went to this barnstorming event from very much the same kind of impulse. And so what I understood was, go about your business, all of you, just go about your business. What happens next is something that leads him to a memory of that experience. So that said, what I'm going to do now is pull all of this stuff out. And let's reopen our X file. And just, you know, I don't expect to use it, but let's put it there just to keep it. And I save that, and I'm closing it. Okay. And now I'm going to turn my music on. And one of you has asked, who is tuned in, I guess, later, a reminder, the music I'm playing is Giacomo Puccini's opera, or highlights from his opera, Turandot. I'm feeling comfortable with where he's about to go in his sensibility. I'm just waiting to see how he gets there. This computer puzzles me at times. There you go. Okay, I'm going to just retype this in. Tell me what's going on there. Jeez. We are all bound to our technology here, and it sometimes intervenes. Okay, this feels really good. Now, I'll tell you where we've suddenly found ourselves here, where I found myself. And and that is that, as I think I've mentioned to you before, I do not make approximations. I need to work out the details, even the specifically the concrete details, and in working in a period piece, those concrete details are sometimes beyond my immediate frame of reference. I cannot go back into my own sense memory and find many of the moment-to-moment details that I need based on my own experience. And so now he goes, go about your business, all of you, just go about your business. But I did not stand. I wanted to stand up and cry out to my tellers and my customers, go about your business, all of you, just go about your business. But I did not stand. I swiveled in my chair and raised my eyes to the window, to the empty morning sky. I had myself gone up into that sky, higher even than Earl Sant. Okay, now I've found my natural entry into a realm of Paul's experience that I had felt from the beginning, and I had felt it in a legitimate, sense-based way. I saw him leaning out of a window or standing before an open window high up in an early skyscraper of that time. And that's where he's going to go now. But as much as I was anguished last night by how little I wrote, it was not how little I wrote. It was that I knew in my heart that I had based whatever I had done, it came from the wrong place. And that's the essential thing. When it comes from the wrong place, once you become attuned to that, it feels terrible. Something just feels really wrong. And that's what had happened to me. These are fewer words than I had here before. And I hope to write more words tonight. But these few words feel good. And where I know Earl is about to move feels good. It feels true to me. So since it is my working method, and it's a method that I feel comfortable with, and I feel comfortable with no other method, I am comfortable right now in taking you folks with me. Let's go to Google. And Google is my favorite web searcher, absolutely. And what I'm looking for is where he went, where Paul went on his trip to New York. And let's start with that. The first thing I need is the building, and I may need more about that time. Now I'm going to put in the Singer Building because, as I say, and that's a bit of knowledge I bring with me from God knows when, from some years ago. I mean, I've read a lot about skyscrapers and early skyscrapers. The Singer Building, as I recall, was the tallest building in the world very briefly, somewhere in the early 1900s. And certainly it was a striking and wonderful sort of Beaux-Arts building. And let's see what we find on the internet. Okay. The first one it gives us is the Singer Tower. Yeah, there it is. I've seen this on, by the way, I collect picture postcards. And I've seen this. There, you notice it was torn down in 1968. What a shame. It's a beautiful building. There's a picture of it from the top. I hope you can see these things. I know you can't read the text very well usually, but I will read the things to you that are appropriate. The Great Singer Tower is knocked down by U.S. Steel in 1967, and that there's nothing important there about the building. This looks like... Okay, Singer was designed by architect Ernest Flagg, completed in 1908. Tallest building in the world at the time. Let's see. Okay, it was green and red. And okay, now I'm going to start taking down details from these websites with a nice period pen. And what I'm after here is green and red terracotta. My beautiful period pen I may have forgotten to fill. Well, there we go. Green and red terracotta. You'll notice the details I'm going to be pulling out here are going to be the concrete things. Okay. And I'm just getting rid of that pink stain there. Building stood 47 stories. And with the lantern, it could be seen from 65 miles away. Five 5,000 tenants carried to their offices by 16 Otis traction elevators. All right. Sad. It was the notorious distinction of being the tallest building in the world ever torn down. Just curious. Let's see the building that went into its place. Oh, my word. I'm looking at the building that went into the place of the Singer building, and I wonder what building that reminds you of. And that's now... standing in its spot. It also carries the title of the world's first electric lit tower. It had lights in the spire of the building. Electric lights in spire. All right. I noticed back when we found these at Google. This is a website I'm kind of familiar with, skyscraper.org. I have been there before. Oh, and look at this, a beautiful postcard of the Singer Building. There it is in all its glory, 612 feet high. And let's see if we learn anything else here. It was constructed from 1906 to 1908, finished 1908. This makes it, and of course, Paul is writing, or his inner monologue is going on in 1913, so actually that's very good, just about right. The Beaux-Arts building, yeah, it is identified as a Beaux-Arts style. Tower of red brick and blue stone. Red brick and blue stone. And blue stone. That's even better. It's those sensual details that you need the most. Okay. Although significantly taller than previous skyscrapers, the Singer Tower held the title for only a year when it was surpassed by the Metropolitan Life Tower. So by the time he had seen it, well, it's maybe not important. All right. You know, let's go back to this site for a moment because there were some other places to click. Photos, etc. an interior view. Let's look at that. Oh my word, isn't that beautiful? Look at the marble, and this is this stuff. Okay. See, now this needs a little more research. Well, perhaps the high arches and the architectural features here are things that I would really like to know. The columns look as if they're marble, squared marble columns rising high into arches. Okay. And the metal and the iron scroll work. I can see there iron scroll work on the balustrades. All right. This is the stuff I need to know. Now, I'm anxious to know, although I don't need to, I think, but I would be interested in knowing if there was like an observation, a specified observation. Well, we've seen the history, and what's the notes and tidbits? Nothing much. All right, let's go back to, okay, we've seen skyscraper.org. Here's a engineering height, and this is an example of the pneumatic caisson sections. This is the technical details of the building. I don't need that so much. A digital archive of American architecture. Okay, Singer Building. Here's that picture postcard again. What a shame that was torn down. And here's a nighttime view. And there's that beacon light. There's the beacon. In an old postcard, shining in four beams, it looks like, in all four directions. Now, one characteristic, as you know, this is well before air conditioning and so forth, so the fact is that all those windows opened up that building. So if we can't clearly, let's see, okay, now I want to see if they had an observation deck, and let's put the word observation in there with Singer Building and see if we get all right, Singer Building here, Empire State Building Observation Deck. Singer Architects, Dr. Bresner's observation is on the blah blah. Oh, here we go. What does this say? Here we are heading into New York City. It's great to be home. Admiral Rickover boards Nautilus and rides with Stithen in New York. Let's ticker tape parade. Oh, here we go. Where they put up an individual hotel rooms transported downtown to see our ticker tape parade from the observation deck up on the Singer Building. All right, this is the Nautilus homepage, the nuclear submarine, and this is before the Singer Building was torn down. And it refers to an observation deck on the Singer Building. I would like something more concrete than that. Let's find Singer. Okay, here's the Singer Building in New York City. French Beaux-Arts style. And you understand, the internet can be dangerous. Look at this. It says it was demolished in 1961. Now, I've seen two other places already when it was 1968, including the pretty authoritative, that skyscraper.org is run by architects, I think. And so that's just downright wrong. Oh, wait a minute. It's a different Singer Building. No, it's the Pulitzer Building. Okay. Now, that's the Singer Building we're talking about. Get the wrong date. Now, but you know, the exact, you know, whether it's red brick and blue stone is the basic material here. The other site said green and red terracotta. A less authoritative site than where I got red brick and blue stone. Ultimately, if green and red terracotta was fitting into a legitimate motif in the story, I would say to hell with even needing to find out about or make a guess at what's most accurate. That would be the detail I'd use. In this case, I think I can go with something. It might have a little more credibility to it. I'm not getting... Okay, here we go. And that's, again, a reference to the observation deck on the Empire State Building. Not getting much here. There does not seem to be because we're looking, there's only 28 hits. And I'm not seeing an observation deck connected to the Singer Building. Okay. Now let's try to place the building a little bit. And I want to know sort of what it looked down on. That's something that we can see the docks here. It's pretty clearly on the it's pretty clearly downtown. But all we need to do is look up One Liberty. The U.S. Steel Building, now known as One Liberty Plaza. All right, let's look up One Liberty Plaza and see if we can find an address for that. I'd like to know where in the city thought that sounded familiar, One Liberty Plaza. It was very near the World Trade Center, was it not? Oh, interesting. I do remember that now. It was very much in that area. And some of you may know, have remembered, and I followed all of the 9/11 stuff pretty closely about the fate of the individual buildings down there. It says status unknown. Did One Liberty Plaza come down also? The view on the One Liberty Plaza from the Hudson River. Oh my word, that photograph that we looked at of One Liberty Plaza was actually taken from the observatory of the World Trade Center. All right, here's the news business. One Liberty Plaza, which rescue workers feared would collapse last week, could be reopened to office tenants next month, according to its owner. So it survived. 53 stories. Okay, so the site of the Singer Building was essentially right next to the site that would eventually become the site of the World Trade Center. Singer Building seems to be the right building for old Paul to go up in. And he would then be looking down on Wall Street, the Wall Street area, or into the, you know, into that area. It's too vague, Wall Street. Let's put Wall Street 1900. Vintage photographs of the stock market. New York Wall Street 1929. New York Wall Street 1900. It was a well-developed area down there. And I'm starting to show the blank spots in my accessible knowledge of history and New York history and so forth. So the Wall Street area is, which is in the, certainly in that ballpark, and could be seen from that high a venue, he would see. And what else could he see? And I'm going to look something up, and maybe, and I'm sure you folks who know New York know I'm either close or being foolish in thinking it might be nearby or visible from the Singer Building. But I'm trying to get a feeling if where exactly is Hell's Kitchen, right? West Village, West 50s down to the Village. So that was not real close. Hell's Kitchen history. Let me just look at this. Indulge me here, and you may know already that I'm on a wild goose chase. Hell's Kitchen area between 34th and 59th from 8th Avenue to the Hudson River. Okay. Okay. Let's look up New York City neighborhoods. My grad assistant tonight, who will be bringing the questions up later, Kimberly Elkins, is a New York City denizen and probably could help me with this, but she's not accessible at the moment. Neighborhood map. Here we go. neighborhood list. Okay. 1, 2, 3. 1. We're looking at now, Financial District, Battery Park, Civic Center. Ah, he could see Liberty Island. He could see Ellis Island. Liberty Island. If he's looking in that direction. Wall Street, maybe. Okay. Okay. I'm going to see if I can get a few more words written now. I may find that I've you know, he'll take one look out the window, and I'm going to feel like I cannot plausibly invent until I do some more research. But we'll see. And indeed, I might, you know, I might get close enough or enough that I can get things down, and then I can, perhaps do a little more research. And don't be upset if I do just a tad bit of research overnight. It's something to do tomorrow and during the day, and I can tell you where I looked. You don't have to follow every step of that. And I will share with you every note I make if I feel the need to. But it will consist of this kind of internet browsing. And also I have some books on skyscrapers and a few on old New York and so forth, and I may just see what's there. And I will be asking the same sorts of questions looking in those books as I'm asking here tonight. But I may not need to. We'll see. So I'm going to go back to, in fact, I'll go back to Ness and Dorma. That's my favorite piece from Turandot. Let's see if we can get back into these words. The impulse is to give certain background things, or how do you enter this? How do you enter through his eyes? Do you enter through his sense of business? You know, where is his heart right now? This is going to take some very serious and perhaps prolonged and very slow working out. So bear with me now. Thank you. Okay, I wanted to stand up and cry out to my tellers and my customers, "Go about your business, all of you, just go about your business." But I did not stand. I swiveled in my chair and raised my eyes to the window, to the empty morning sky. I had myself gone up into that sky, higher even than Earl Sant. I had stood in the air. I had stood and looked out on a great city, on a world of business and banking, a world of making goods and buying and selling and building houses and factories, and I looked out on steamships and trains and bridges and far off a vast sea, and I was standing within a thing as great as all of that. The Singer Building, the highest building in the world at the moment in the summer of 1909, when my host, a fellow banker, lifted his office window on the 45th floor, and I trembled like a horse before fire. I crept forward and I felt my chest swell. I grew large with fear and happiness to look at this city, vast and multiform in its stone and marble and terracotta, the work of human hands. I stepped closer still. I grew bold. The air moved on my face, an air only the clouds knew. But I was part of a race of creatures of the earth who were remaking themselves into something new. I took the last step a man could take and not fall. I pressed against the sill, and I bent forward at the waist and looked across the rooftops below, rooftops that themselves were higher than any tree on earth, but far below me now. And I looked beyond the docks and masts and smokestacks. I followed the bright thread of the Hudson River to Ellis Island and the statue of Madame Liberty, her arm lifted high. What strange joy Earl Sant must have felt even in the moment just before he died. My only problem at the moment is with the presumption of that feeling. I'm not convinced that that would be, in fact, I'm not. That's wrong. What must Earl Sant? That strange joy thing is just abstract and wrong. So I'm just going to leave it with the question tonight, and maybe the question will stand as an actual sentence tomorrow. Or maybe it's just a question to myself. I don't know yet. What must Earl Sant have felt in the moment just before he died? It may remain as a question. But anyway, up to there, I feel much better tonight. Much better. This feels like the right place for Earl's consciousness, as opposed to the things I was trying to wheel in and wheel out last time. Okay. It's time for our questions of the evening. And while Kimberly makes her way upstairs, I'm going to address an email that came in today. It's not quite a question. One of my more articulate viewers out in Kanata, Ontario, Jody, who I think we've had her questions before. She says, you mentioned the use of the word lift last night, and I was going to ask you about this before. A lot of things lift and fall in the story, not just Earl's plane. There is a frequent sense of up and down. By the way, I can read this now. This is the kind of thing that got me going last night into the wrong area. But Jody makes some wonderful observations here, and it's something I can comment on tonight now, especially after having written. Okay, a lot of things lift and fall in the story, not just Earl's plane. There is a frequent sense of up and down. For example, when Paul is looking up at the sky where Earl Sant was, his son's voice drifts up to him. That's one of the sections I mentioned last night. The upward movement of Matthew's voice is countered by his father's hand on his shoulder, which seems maybe an unconscious attempt to keep him down, rooted to the earth. Good point. Later, Paul identifying himself with the maple. Good. As if he wants to prevent his son from becoming airborne. Not really far-fetched. There is this palpable physical tension there. You're absolutely right about that, Jody. It's not far-fetched at all. It's exactly the sensual pattern that's going on. Rachel kneeling on one knee when Matt is very rooted to the ground. Her face finally lifts up to Paul. The fact that she doesn't lift her face to Paul, it lifts by itself, seems to make her more of a natural presence, tree-like, sheltering and nurturing Matthew. This is quite true. The sight of her precedes Paul's identification with the maple. I wondered about that connection, and I think you're right about it. Later, she is ghost-like and floats. The wind is important, too. Later, lifting a scrap of paper along the ground. Planes lift, voices lift, cameras lift, coffee cups lift, but most often people's eyes lift. I'm glad you talked about this last night and hope you continue to address it. Thanks for this, Jody. An excellent observation, Jody. You know, it's interesting. All that stuff came from my unconscious. It came from my dream space because I was utterly unaware of it until last night. If you recall, last night's the first time I made an issue of the lifting, which I suddenly began to be aware of in that major read-through I did last night. And that's why I paused at that moment. Now, again, I would not have an excellent literary observer like Jody observing my story for me as I write under normal conditions. I would not myself be pressing myself. Come in, Kimberly. Yes, Kimberly's here. This is Kimberly Elkins, one of my graduate students from New York City. And these are the questions. Thank you very much. And see you tomorrow. Great. And thanks for the tip on this. Yes, Kimberly is telling me about Hell's Kitchen, which we did find on the internet. It says Hell's Kitchen is West 57th to West 39th, I'm pretty sure, from 12th Avenue, Hudson River to 8th Avenue. East-West definition, I'm sure about North-South could go as far as West 59th and so forth. Whatever, he's not looking straight down on it, which was the point. And Tracy Hessler says the observation deck was on the 30th floor of the Singer Building. Thank you, Tracy. I want to get him up higher, which is interesting to know, but I want to get him up higher anyway. So I've got him looking out the window, and as I say, the windows do open. I wanted to get him looking out the window of the Singer Building, and as high as I can. And the window's open, so that's good. Well, thanks, Tracy, for that bit of information, and thank you, Kimberly, as well. But as I was saying about Jody's comment, it was only last night that I discovered this connection in a way that I could articulate in these kind of lit crit ways. You know, this analysis, which I have great respect for. And which is certainly accurate in a certain, in a kind of translated way. But all of that motif, the lifting and falling motif, rising and falling motif, which I think you can understand, is inherently organic and apt for the subject matter of this story. All that stuff I was unaware of until my seventh. Is this the, you know, this is the ninth night, to my eighth night. So, is that right? Yeah, was it the eighth, tenth? Yeah. On my eighth night, I finally figured out that that was going on in these terms. Now, my unconscious knew it was going on. My unconscious was in fact, working that very consistently. What your unconscious does, what your dream space does, what your sense memory does, is it becomes very responsive to those underlying sensual patterns of things. And once it finds those, and once it feels like it's organic to all the other things going on, it works those things. It works them. It works them. It keeps yielding them up. And it's going on tonight as well in those terms. And that's what's apt about Jody's comment, but also you understand, I'm going to say once again, the importance of it is that it's happening and it's coming from the unconscious. Donna asks, I understand that you do your significant writing in the mornings when you are in circumstances where you must write at the end of the day, like this, or on a weekend. Do you ever find that by taking the edge off with a glass of wine or such frees your mind to be in its dream space any better? That's interesting. You know something, Donna? I don't drink alcohol at all. I am the antithesis of the classic writer in that respect. I really envy my friends who love wine because it looks like great fun, but I just don't like the taste of alcohol. And so I have never done that about taking the edge off. I have always also not sought out the alteration of my senses. And I'm not saying no to your question, Donna. A given writer might well find, just as often people find that a glass of wine, not so much alcohol as to get drunk, but just a little bit of something of that sort helps them to sleep, helps them to move into their unconscious in that way. It may well be, Donna, that might help. It doesn't help me. My concern about alcohol, not only do I not drink alcohol, I don't even wear sunglasses. And those two comments are related. I find, and this is just personal, I'm not projecting this onto anyone else, any other writer. Everyone must find their own way into their unconscious. But they must find their way into their unconscious with the means to then shape it and be open to it, respond to it, and pull it through language. And certainly a glass of wine wouldn't alter that. But I have always feared, and not feared exactly, I've certainly avoided instinctively anything that would alter my senses. I am ravenous for life through the senses, and I think that's characteristic of writers in general, artists. But I have also then turned away from anything that might alter my sensual perceptions. I don't want anything to come between me and the moment, because it's in the moment that I find my inspiration. But I'm not saying that might not work for some folks, Donna. I'll look at the rest of your comment. These are new to me. That's your question, and I'm interested. I'm just kind of reading ahead and interested in the rest of your comment, which I'll read tonight, about visualizing Earl. Okay. A question from John Kenyon. He says, in first putting things down on paper, how do you decide how much is enough in terms of detail and description, exposition, dialogue, everything? Do you keep it spare with the idea of fleshing it out later, or do you throw everything in on the first pass and cut it down to the essential parts on the rewrite? Right. Well, that's an interesting question. What I do may not be what a lot of other writers do. When I talked last night about this method that I teach about how to pre-dream a novel, I describe two different approaches to the novel. One of which is that great is the writer of the great sprawling rough draft. Those writers tend to put, as John describes it, put everything in on the first pass. And for draft writers, that works very well, because I have some wonderful writer friends I know who are draft writers, and if you read about great writers of the past, many of them were draft writers, and they would do this. I take a different approach, but I do not do the other thing that you describe here, John. I do not deliberately keep it spare with the idea of fleshing it out later. Every sentence I write it and work it over with the intent of making it just right in this regard, neither too lean nor too fat, to write each sentence and work them over so that they are organically correct and resonant in terms of the whole object that's being created. And that's my working method. I know a lot of writers put it all in and cut it back. I don't know so very many writers. I'm trying to think if any of my friends whose methods I know. I would be a little concerned about deliberately writing it spare and then fleshing it out. The sparer you get, the more risk you run of sliding up out of the moment, and indeed sliding up out of the senses. And what you end up writing is just summary and generalization, I'm afraid, and maybe then even more abstractions. I would think that method carries a lot of risk with it that I certainly wouldn't be willing to take. And I don't know of any of my artist friends who do. So that method seems very risky to me. The other method I know works, that you then have to go in and cut a lot away. I'm in between there. I do try to make each sentence just right before I go on to the next. And obviously, they can't be just right ultimately, many of them, because what the object becomes may then, in retrospect, alter things. And you've seen me already go back and alter and alter. I've done so. I did so last night, even very near the beginning of the story. A question from Guy Downing. Is writing always a struggle, as we're seeing on the webcast, always a challenge to find what you are writing about, narrator versus his own experience? Always reread out loud as many times. Okay, let me get this one at a time. Is it always a struggle? It's always a struggle. The answer is yes. Sometimes in the struggle, it's like when the cowboy gets on the bucking bronco, is it always a struggle? Absolutely. Even when the bronco settles down a little bit and the cowboy has some control and they're actually riding and he's, waving his hand and staying in the saddle, is it still a struggle? Yes, it is. It's looking easier. The job is getting done, but it's still a struggle. And so it is with writing from the unconscious. Do I always reread out loud as many times? As I think I mentioned before in other cases, I always read out loud a fair amount. I don't read out loud quite as much as I do in the webcast, but I reread as much as I do in the webcast. Sometimes it's just to myself when I'm reading occasionally out loud here, but I do reread aloud very often. Is this a rough draft or will it be near final? Well, it will be near final in the same way as I was just answering John's question a few moments ago. I do work things over. My rough drafts appear and reappear and reappear in the sentences. Now, please understand, I will go back and rework. And I'm prepared in going back, redreaming and hearing for those twangy places instead of the thrumming. I am prepared to rewrite and redo in radical ways. But generally, what I do, even when it's extreme for me, is not the same as what the draft type writers do. Where things are really approximated as they go. What time of day do you usually write? And why and how many hours per day? I usually write in the morning. I usually write 2 or 3 hours. And the mornings for me are just a little closer to the original dream state that I was in when I woke up. M.J. Lord of Tallahassee asked, obviously, you do not now write autobiographical fiction, but have you ever? No. And what do you think are the inherent problems with autobiographical fiction? Well, nothing that, yeah, the lousy stuff I wrote, and this is not, the lousy stuff I wrote, if you aspire to art, autobiographical fiction is almost an oxymoron. Because the art, a work of fictional art depends on the total malleability of the object. And if you write about autobiographically, you become beholden to literal things that have happened in your life far too often. Now, in a deeper sense, all great art is autobiographical in that it's about my white-hot center, the deepest part of my unconscious self. And, of course, that is so autobiographical as to transcend autobiography. To the extent that the word autobiography summons up a consciousness of literal memories of your life and your past. To that extent, I say that art is not autobiographical and cannot be a work of fictional art. Which is not to say you can't write a perfectly interesting and wonderful fictional object that's autobiographical, but possibly could, but it would not be a work of art. It would have other kinds of values to it. If it has value, it would be other kinds of values. Entertainment value, or with the knowledge that it's all but autobiographical, certain sort of the values of a memoir or whatever. The rest of the question, you think it's possible to create literary art that is based on autobiography. Defining autobiography is that as the embrace of and use of literal remembered events in your life, no, where they are there because they are from you. But the other sense of autobiography where, you know, your deepest forgotten dream space is autobiographical in perhaps the deepest sense, that in that case all art is autobiographical. Well, we've come to the end of another session, and I thank you very much for joining me. Please come back tomorrow night at 9 and join us again as we see where our narrator leads us next in this increasingly intense conflict within his soul. Good night.